Hi, welcome back to Existential Psychology here at the University of West Georgia. This video will be number two in a series where we'll be looking at the work of Rollo May and more specifically at his book, The Discovery of Being. Okay, in the last video we introduced the book, I gave you a reading assignment, and most of the content of the last video about Rollo May had to do with how he traces out the historical lineage, as it were, of existential psychology and existentialism more generally, I suppose. And he has rather a lengthy treatment about the interrelationship between the Industrial Revolution and the advent of existential thinking. And then we focused a little bit more specifically on existential thinking as it appeared in the American scene right around the middle of the 20th century. In this video, we'll be continuing to ride right along in parallel with the book. And the first item that we'll get into has to do with a connection between modern art and existential thinking. So we're going to be continuing sort of that way of situating existential thinking within the larger ambit of cultural forces and also historical forces. So this time the focus is going to be a little bit on art. And he names three artists in that regard, Van Gogh, Cézanne, and Picasso. Okay, now if you think about the art that you've seen from those three, probably the first thing that will occur to you, most especially in Picasso probably, is that, well, this is not photographic realism. Okay, so it's not the type of art that is trying to depict things in a way like a photograph would, and to try to emulate that kind of realistic portrayal of things. It's much more toward the impressionistic. I guess in terms of lineage, Van Gogh, of course, was 19th century, latter half of the 19th century, so was Cézanne. Picasso, mostly, let's say, first half of the 20th century. He lasted a long time. He was extremely prolific, too. At any rate, the art is a little bit on the impressionistic side, for sure. So he localizes four points of intersection between artists like this and the kind of existentialism that was emerging at the same time toward the latter half of the 19th century, first half of the 20th century. So, number one point of intersection, a revolt against the hypocritical academic tradition of the late 19th century, particularly with respect to artistic expression. So what does he mean by that? Well, what he means is that this type of art, and in a way, existentialism too, was a way of rebelling against the hyper, overly refined way the academic world had of seeing both art and philosophical activity, for that matter. From Rollo May's point of view, in both instances, things had gotten a little bit overly precious, as it were, a little bit overly refined, a little bit more for the cognoscenti and not for people at large. Okay, so there was a kind of elitism here as part of what he's talking about. And he finds that there was a fair degree of hypocrisy running through all of that, you know, because if art is supposed to, or existential thinking is supposed to be, you know, exploring some of the fundamental truths of our age or even the fundamental truths of human existence, you would expect that there would be something more to it than a kind of dull, narrow elitism. All right. So number two, a second point of intersection, an endeavor to pierce below surfaces to grasp a new relation to the reality of nature. Okay, so both that kind of art, all right, so the art, impressionistic, you know, maybe going into abstract expressionism like Jackson Pollock or someone in the middle of the 20th century, stuff like that, was an attempt to pierce below sort of the obvious play of surfaces and try to fathom not only, I would say, a new relation to the reality of nature, but a new relation to reality as such, okay? You know, so to try to see more deeply into things than we typically would do. And that would be true both of this mode of art and also true of existentialism. And that's why this mode of art is not photographic realism, because it's looking for something much deeper than that. You know, I think I might number Monet, perhaps, among those types of artists. Speaking of impressionism, I'm sort of a fan of Monet. Many people are, I think. At any rate, at least in the United States where I live. Okay, so number three, an endeavor to recover vitality, an honest, direct, aesthetic experience, and especially the kind of honest, direct aesthetic experience that more or less everyone, or at least most people, can connect up with, you know? So an attempt to see things more directly in a way that is not sort of deflected and diffracted through the lenses of a kind of overweening elitism, which is basically what he's talking about in item number one. Okay, and finally, number four, both existentialism and modern art represent the desperate attempt to express the immediate underlying meaning of the modern human situation, even when this means portraying despair and emptiness. And maybe the best example of this might be Picasso's famous painting entitled Guernica. Okay, so which was a painting. You might want to look it up on the internet so you can see it. But it's kind of a horrific painting about the destruction of an entire town during war. Another, I think, work of art, late 19th century, this time Norwegian, Edvard Munch's The Scream. Okay, so, and that's probably a famous one that I bet you've seen too. Like Guernica, maybe you haven't seen that because, I don't know, maybe you have. Let's just assume you have and give you the benefit of the doubt. How about that? Because that's how much I care. Okay, so what we see, all in all, is like a real parallelism between these movements, impressionism, and that sort of movement in modern art, non-representational type art, like Picasso, is definitely not in the photographic realism type camp, if you're not familiar with his work, and existentialism in those regards, basically sort of dropping off some of the baggage of an overweening elitism, trying to be a little bit more honest with respect to reality than we typically are, trying to pierce below the play of surfaces and establish a deeper relation to reality itself. Okay, so that's sort of the first item on the agenda for this video. Second item on the agenda is to take a look at another kind of point of intersection he describes, this time an intersection between existential thinking and what he calls Eastern thinking. And what he means more specifically by Eastern thinking is Zen Buddhism, first of all, and Lao Tzu, okay, so Taoism, all right? So personally, I think that if I were writing this section of the book, I wouldn't localize it quite so specifically in those two modes of thought, but I would include Buddhism as a whole. So, Theravada, Mahayana, and Vajrayana modes of Buddhism. I would probably also include Hinduism in this, in addition to the ones he was talking about. So, at any rate, that's me. Okay. Possibly extrapolating a little bit on Rollo May. So this time he notices three points of intersection. And incidentally, maybe before we get into this, you might notice that these kinds of Eastern thinking are becoming much more predominant in the Western world in the 20th century, despite the fact that they existed for millennia in the East. Okay, so, all right. Number one, both existentialism and Eastern philosophies are concerned with ontology, the study of being. So they tend to see life in terms of states of being and states of consciousness and that sort of thing. So at least implicitly, if not explicitly, they both are concerned with the issues of being as such. And that's part of both existentialism's and Eastern thinking's desire to see things in a much more fundamental way than we typically do. So, number two, in that same vein, they both seek a relation to reality which cuts below the cleavage between subject and object. Okay, so let's just recycle back on the notes from the last video to his characterization of existentialism generally, in which he said, existentialism, in short, is the endeavor to understand man by cutting below the cleavage between subject and object. So we have the same kind of idea here, except now he's saying that, well, it's not just existentialism, like there's a connection to Eastern thinking in that regard too. Like it's sort of like that yin-yang symbol, like this time I'll try to draw it, unlike Edvard Munch's The Scream or something. It's that sort of circular thing that has kind of a wave, like here's the circle and there's sort of a dot of the opposite color in between. Well, what's the deal there? Well, the deal there is it's an illustration of the principle of complementarity, which pervades many aspects of reality. But in this case, we're focused on subjectivity and objectivity. So from a point of view of Eastern thinking, also from the point of view of existentialism, as we discussed in your Getting Starting videos, they tend to see things holistically in a way that is more radical and more fundamental than our usual dichotomous way of viewing subjectivity on one hand and experience on that side, then objectivity and things like the natural sciences on the other hand. Well, if you apply that yin-yang sort of logic to the question of subjectivity and objectivity, you're going to see that, well, you know, they're always mutually informing and influencing one another, and that really reality is not the additive sum of them, but an ongoing reciprocal process between the two. Okay, so number three. So what are we doing again? Connections between existentialism and Eastern thinking. Both would insist that the Western absorption in conquering and gaining power over nature has resulted not only in the estrangement of man from nature, but also indirectly in the estrangement of man from himself. Okay, so from his point of view, they both embody this kind of critique that, you know, the world in which we live is not something to be treated like a resource to be consumed and then thrown away, like, you know, like new land or whatever there is, like that whole sort of project of just trying to conquer nature and put our boot on the neck of nature and to try to crack the bones as best we can, you know, and thereby gratify our desires somehow. It's like, yeah, here's the thing about that. Like, if you really have a kind of holistic view of existence, that means that the environment we inhabit is integral to our constitution every bit as much as our constitution is integral to the environment we inhabit. So if you're going to seek to conquer nature, really, ultimately, that's a way of conquering ourselves. All right, because like if you see things that way, like what we are and what the world is are knit together. Once again, a little bit like that yin-yang symbol, okay? They're complementary elements of the larger holistic totality. So the whole business of trying to sort of conquer nature and subjugate nature and, you know, consume nature as though it were just a resource without an intrinsic value to our lives is, he says it has estranged us from nature, first of all, and then indirectly estranged us from ourselves, because our deeper nature, so to speak, is to realize that the world we inhabit is integral to what we are, and what we are is integral to what the world is. Okay, so we're estranged from the deeper sense for life, you know. Aside from that, it all works out just fine. That is sarcasm, by the way, for those who are not fluent. I studied sarcasm as a second language in college. I've studied three other languages, maybe four besides English, so you probably figured it out if you watch these videos. Like, I was sort of a classicist when I was young and a kid, so I studied Latin and Greek, and then classical Greek, that is, and Spanish. I also, me gusta hablar español de vez en cuando. Anyhow, the next thing he does is he looks at three thinkers, okay, in the existential tradition, according to him, although one of these thinkers is probably going to be a little bit surprising to you, perhaps. So the three thinkers are Kierkegaard, Nietzsche, and Freud, all right? So Soren Kierkegaard, we've mentioned his name before, all right? So first half of the 19th century, let's remember what I said about Soren Kierkegaard before, okay? What I said was very theistic, okay, very God-centered, religious, for sure. Very individualistic, too, okay? I also said that he's really the progenitor of modern existentialism as we know it. Okay, first half of the 19th century, basically, into the mid-19th century. So a few ideas on Soren Kierkegaard, although in the next video I'm going to talk in a lot more depth about Soren Kierkegaard. But for now, let's just ride in parallel with what Rollo May's saying. So probably, I think, one of the best ideas from Kierkegaard is that he draws a distinction between two modes of truth. The first mode of truth, I'm going to invert it from how I'm saying it in your notes a little bit is what he calls objective truth. And that's truth the way we probably normally think about it, you know, because when we think about, well, what is truth? Well, in our modern era, when we think about the truth, probably most of us think about what is objectively verifiable, okay? You know, and especially by way of scientific empirical inquiry, that's what's true. It's things that are empirically verifiable, and especially from the point of view of scientific inquiry. And of course, the whole thrust of scientific inquiry is to be as objective as possible. The second mode of objective truth, according to Kierkegaard, has to do with abstract truths, like the truths of mathematics, for instance, you know, like the Pythagorean theorem or something like that, you know, like our the chain rule of differential calculus, if you've taken a little bit of higher math, or the truths of Laplace transforms, if you've taken differential equations or something like that. Okay, so I don't want to sort of make you too dizzy, because I know that sometimes if you start talking math, students tend to get a little queasy. Might need a barf bag at any rate. So objective truth. The truths of the empirical sciences, most obviously in our world. Also abstract truths like the truths of mathematics, and also propositional logic. Okay, so those kinds of abstract truths fall under the rubric of objective truth. Okay, so what about the other category, subjective truth? Okay, now this sounds like a contradiction perhaps to you, because it's a little bit counterintuitive with respect to how our culture sees truths. Some truths, it turns out, are not a matter of scientific empirical inquiry or consensus among scientists about what is actually the case, like that F equals ma, let's say, force equals mass times acceleration, or equals mc squared if you're more of an Einsteinian type person. Sometimes you have to experience something firsthand in order for it to count as a truth at all. And that might be sort of a weird thing for you to hear. So let me tell you a little story about this. Going to tell you a story. So, and this, I'm doing that voice because the story is about Louis Armstrong, who was a famous jazz trumpet player in the 20th century. One of the early, seminal forces in the emergence of jazz music. He was also a vocalist, and I bet if you heard his voice, you would recognize it. You know, it was kind of like really sort of low and gruff, like rah, 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 you know, a little bit like Tom Waits maybe. but at any rate, these news reporters once went up to Louis Armstrong and they wanted to find out like what this new jazz music was all about. So because Louis Armstrong was famous and, you know, he was great and all of that kind of stuff, they went up to him to ask him, and, you know, like, Louis, like, what is jazz? What is this jazz music all about? And his response, I'll translate it slightly, but his response was basically, if you have to ask that question, you won't understand the answer. It's like, oh, damn, man, that's almost like a Zen Koan or something, you know? In other words, okay, what is he meaning? In other words, what he means is if you have no experiential reference point for understanding jazz, which is probably what would lead you to ask the question, what is jazz? If you have no experience with it at all, then no matter what he could tell you about jazz would be a misunderstanding, right? You know, because he wouldn't be getting at the essence of jazz. Jazz is something you have to experience. Someone can't just sort of write a paragraph for you about jazz if you've never heard it. And at the end of the paragraph, I understand perfectly. Like, there's some unusual modulations and, unusual time signatures and departures from, blah, 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 blah. You know, that won't mean anything to you. Okay, so if you don't get it, like, a lot of truths are like that when you think about it. It's like, what about the truth of falling in love? Well, you know, you could read Romeo and Juliet, or if you're a student of Latin like I was when I was young, you could read Catullus or someone like that from the ancient world. These beautiful literary descriptions of what falling in love is like. Well, guess what? It won't mean a damn thing unless you have some kind of experiential reference point, excuse me, for understanding those words. Some truths have to be experienced before they can count in your life as a truth at all. Oh my goodness. Okay. So Kierkegaard's take all in all, objective truth has its proper place. No one's denying that. Okay. So like if you want to understand what's happening in a test tube or how, you know, like physical objects like move throughout the world, your best bet is to rely on objective truth, like the truths of the empirical sciences and combined with mathematical truths and that sort of thing. All right. So time and place for it. But when the objective truth has run out, okay, subjective truth has to take over. Okay, so when you reach the limit of what is objectively ascertainable as the truth, and you still have important questions to ask, all of a sudden, experiential type truths need to take over at that point. So for Kierkegaard, one example, maybe the example par excellence of an subjective truth would be Christian faith. Okay, so it's not a matter of any empirical observation or any sort of abstract, logically coherent argument, such as that proposed most famously by St. Anselm in the tradition of medieval scholasticism, which was a medieval mode of philosophy. Okay, so all of that is beside the point from his point of view. Okay, because Christian faith is a matter of subjective truth. It's like, if you have to ask the question, you won't understand the answer. Okay, it's one of those. All right, because second item from Kierkegaard to run in parallel with Rollo May's treatment, an emphasis on passion and commitment. Okay, so commitment in the sense of religious faith is a kind of commitment, and a passionate one for Kierkegaard too. So the insistence on passion, by the way, if you'll remember from the last video when he was talking about the compartmentalization of the emotions as opposed to will and reason, right? So this is Kierkegaard's way of putting weight on the other side of the scale and seeking to rebalance the scales with respect to our tendency to idolize reason. Okay, and overvalue reason at the expense of the emotions. And finally, an emphasis on the individual as over against the system, intellectual or cultural, and maybe just a side note, like especially a world historical dialectical system like that proposed by Hegel a little bit before Kierkegaard. In part, he's reacting to understand that world that way. If you don't understand that, that's okay. I guess that's just a little... you know, you throw a bone every now and then for people who have some background in Hegel or whatever. Okay, second thinker. Okay, first one, Søren Kierkegaard. And like I said, after this video and the next one, I'm going to talk about him a lot more than we are right now because he's important. Second thinker, whom we'll also be talking about quite at length later on in the semester, is Friedrich Nietzsche. Okay, so there's life dates 1844. 1900, although he had a psychotic break in 1889, so the life dates there are a little misleading, but at any rate, second half of the 19th century, and sort of Rollo May claims, and I think rightly so, that part of Nietzsche's claim to fame is that he paved the way in a way for the idea of the Freudian unconscious with his idea of the will to power, although... I think, to be honest, I think like Nietzsche was somewhat indebted to Schopenhauer for his conception of will. I think he kind of lifted Schopenhauer's conception of will in his formulation of the will to power, but hey, that's just me. But Rollo May's point is that Nietzsche's idea of the will to power paved the way for the Freudian unconscious. Why? Because the will of the will to power is not will in the usual sense at all. And I'm moving my hands up here because the way we think of will in the usual sense is it's sort of like stuff within the purview of your awareness and more specifically your power of volition, making choices, making decisions, and so on. For Nietzsche, the will is something much more sort of primitive and animalistic than that, a little bit like Schopenhauer's conception of the will. Okay, and finally, here's the surprising one. We'll end the video with a possible surprise. Sigmund Freud is the last thinker he names. Now, the reason why I said this is a surprise is because Sigmund Freud is never really numbered among the existentialists. Instead, he's numbered among the psychoanalytic thinkers, okay? In fact, he's the seminal psychoanalytic thinker. So his life dates toward the very end of the 19th century, definitely into the early part of the 20th century he was writing. So now what you have to understand about thinkers like Rollo May, such that he would include Sigmund Freud in this list, is that almost all of the early existential psychologists came from the psychoanalytic camp, and that includes Rollo May, who was an Adlerian. Okay, so for that reason, they're all very sympathetic to psychoanalytic thinking, and I think that's where this is coming from. Like, he names Freud as opening up the possibility of ecstatic reason, although, to be honest, like, I think like it would be equally easy to attribute that to a thinker like Nietzsche, but he doesn't, okay? So he relies on Freud for this. So ecstatic reason is a phrase we mentioned in an earlier video. I was talking about it with respect to contrasting it with instrumental reason, or, as Rollo May puts it, technical reason. So there's more to reasoning than just being sort of means, ends, rational, and instrumental about things, okay? So there comes a point for you to become a passionate thinker. All right. And like I said in the previous video, I can't remember which video it was, like, I hope you students are becoming passionate thinkers and not merely mechanically proficient thinkers. Like if you have no deep sense for what the activity of thinking is, well, maybe you ought to pick up some other hobby. Maybe you should become a musician or an artist or do something that you feel real passion about. Because if you live your entire life without passion, you can wonder whether you've lived at all. At least in the deep sense, maybe in a biological sense, you fulfill your sort of biological continuity. Yeah, who cares? Who cares? Rats and roaches do that too. Okay, so the real challenge of life isn't that. The real challenge of life is to become something like a passionate thinker, if you're inclined to thinking. Not everyone in the world is. Okay, so his contribution, that is Sigmund Freud's contribution, according to Rollo May, is introducing this business of something like ecstatic reason, which would include things like intuition, the passions, once again, a poetic or musical sensibility, you know, as ways of understanding the world. Okay, so the heart has its reasons, the reason knows not of. Once again, I'm quoting Pascal. I love that quote. You could probably figure that out. So this is what he's getting at with that. Okay, so three thinkers. Okay, so Kierkegaard, Nietzsche, and Freud, although Freud's status among the existentialists is dubious at best. Okay, in the next video, I'm going to do what I said I was going to do. Odd how that works, huh? Which is, I'm going to depart a little bit from the Rollo May book and tell you a lot more about Søren Kierkegaard at this point. So you can look forward to that, or dread that, as the case may be. But in any case, have a good one. Okay, take care.